Hi everybody, welcome to our latest series for advanced listeners. We're going to be actually exploring some of India's largest stocks together, and I'm going to be sharing you some of our thoughts on it, etc. So it will promise to be a pretty fun session. Before we kick into the analysis, I wanted to just briefly talk about how to use these sessions right, because there are a lot of ways to use them wrongly. Which you really want to guard against. So the first is, prior to watching this series, I highly recommend that you watch our Stocks Zero to Hero series. See every single video in that series, because that's really what this series is going to build on. It's going to assume that you are familiar with that knowledge, and if you're not, you may get a little lost. So I think it'll benefit you if you've watched those videos first. Those are all available on our YouTube channel and in the Stock Zero to Hero playlist. So what we're trying to do with this series is give you a glimpse into how fundamental research is used to make decisions about whether to buy or sell stocks. And this is the actual research we're using for our Barossa Top 150 Small Case. So it's a lot of fun for us to do. Anyway, we're doing this work on our own, and it's a chance for us to share that work with you guys, and hopefully you guys will benefit from it, and we'll all together learn about how some of the largest companies in the Indian markets work. But what I want to guard against is for you to take our opinions as fact. We are making guesses and judgments about the future that could very well be wrong. We've made a lot of wrong decisions in the past. We try our best to make more right decisions than wrong decisions, but any particular decision, you shouldn't assume just because we've expressed a view here that necessarily will happen. We always recommend that prior to ever transacting in an individual stock, you need to do your own homework. So we're going to spell out our logic for you in this series, but that doesn't mean you have to agree with our logic. You could disagree. You could say that, hey, I see the argument, but I don't fully agree with the point. And you may come to the reverse conclusion as us, and that's great. What we're trying to do in this series is to give you a flavor of how the analysis is done, how you can do your own analysis, and also give you a flavor of the kind of work that goes in behind our small case and the kind of thinking that we have around it. So if you're a small case investor, and you're seeing these videos and you're not sure you agree with our philosophies and thoughts about the overall market, it'll give you a chance to manage your portfolio appropriately. Or on the other hand, if you like the things we're saying, then it'll give you a chance to increase your allocations. So that's really how I would use this video. It's a great way for you to understand more about your manager. It's a great way for you to also learn how to apply these same skills to your own portfolios and your own individual stocks. So with that little preface, why don't we jump into the presentation on the stock we're going to be discussing first, which is Divi's Laboratories. And we're not going to finish our analysis in this session itself. This will probably spill into another session, but this will lay a very good groundwork about kind of the sniff test that I use to quickly assess whether a stock is worth doing serious work on or not. So this is kind of the first pass analysis that I do for any stock that I look at, and trying to determine whether I want to take a big position in it in our small case or not. So you can see that our current small case, there are about three big positions that we have. I'm currently evaluating whether if there are any others that I can add to being conviction picks for our small case. So let's jump in here and learn a little bit about Divi's labs. So, so let's get a quick look at what Divi's Laboratories is all about. So a few basic facts here that I gleaned from the annual report. So Divi's is a manufacturer of active pharmaceutical ingredients, both generics as well as customized solutions. So around 60% are generic APIs and 40% are customized solutions. And if you're not familiar with what an API is, it's basically a component that's biologically active, which is used in the production of final pharmaceuticals. So you can think of, you know, the drug Tylenol or Crocin, the active ingredient in that would be paracetamol, right? So it's really the chemical that's very biologically active in any pharmaceutical. So Divi's manufactures these for both generic drugs as well as customized drugs, which means drugs for that are branded and have IP protecting them. So 40% are for branded and IP protected drugs and 60% are generic drugs. And these products are exported to approximately 95 countries. The customers are here that are buying directly from Divi's are global pharma companies and nutraceutical companies. So basically Divi's is a manufacturer, an outsourced manufacturer for pharmaceutical companies. And Divi's is one of the leading API companies in India. It's got 5,400 crores in annual revenue and 1,825 crores in operating profit, which is a 30% profit margin. So right off the bat, we're seeing that this is a highly profitable company. 30% margins is something that caught my eye right away. And the other thing that jumped out from the annual report is that this is a fairly capital intensive business. It takes a lot for this company to manufacture the products it's making. So there's 14,000 employees that it has, there are 3 R&D facilities all in India, 6 manufacturing facilities again all in India, and 2 marketing offices abroad. So this is not an easy business to do. That's a lot of both research and manufacturing prowess that goes into this and a pretty heavy employee base as well. So seems like an interesting company at first glance. Let's learn more. So what are we going to do here? So the first game plan that I generally do when I'm looking at a stock for the first time is the first most important thing we need to understand is why does this company exist? Why are customers choosing to use this company's product? And how is this company adding value ultimately into the marketplace? It's very dangerous for you to skip this step because this is the fundamental core of what you're buying when you're buying a stock. You're buying a little piece of a company, and if that company is not adding a lot of value in the market, then the company itself, there's a very low chance it'll be valuable. So we need to really understand why a customer decides to use Divi to manufacture its product, its pharmaceuticals. Step two, we're going to do a high level review of some of the information that we can pull on Divi's easily to see if it passes a sniff test, which means that, look, this investment looks interesting enough to determine whether we should do step three or not. And step three is basically a detailed due diligence plan and figuring out how to determine if this is a stock that we really want to take a big position in or not. And step four is figuring out exactly the nuances of that plan and how we're going to go about analyzing it further. So let's get on with step one. So little basics on Divi's performance. And a lot of people ask me, you know, do you use charts in your analysis and do you care about technicals and all? I personally am not a big fan of relying on technicals. They definitely can drive short-term moves in stock prices, but understanding technicals is something that is very uncertain and difficult to do right, and it can be very costly if you don't do it right. There's nothing fundamental anchoring the value of your business when you're relying on technical indicators. But on the other hand, I do like charts to tell me about what's been going on with the company, right? And what kind of bias I should have when researching the company. So here's an example of a company that's been doing very, very well. So you can see that, you know, at the beginning of the year, it was roughly at around 1700 rupees. It's now trading at an all-time high, essentially, of 350 rupees. So it's really, really performed well. It's barely got hit in COVID and then bounced back very, very quickly, which kind of makes sense. It's a pharma-linked company. So demand is going to be very resilient here. The other thing that caught my eye, and I don't usually trust, ratios that are available like this publicly, but I double checked this ratio and it's correct. So there's a PE ratio of 55 times here. So that's a very high PE ratio also. The average stock in the Indian markets is going to be around 23, 24 times PE on a trailing basis. And so when you're talking about 55, times PE ratio, that's twice as expensive as an average stock. So why did I look at this chart? Because I want to know what bias I should have in my research. Generally, I do the opposite bias of whatever the chart tells me. If investors really like the stock right now, when I'm doing my research, I have a bias to find reasons why not to like the stock. Because you're going to be tempted to just jump on the bandwagon. But if you're really looking at delivering alpha in the markets, you have to look for contrarian opportunities where maybe you find a stock that people think is not great, but you think is great. Or you find a stock where everyone thinks it's great, but you don't think it's great. You can look at buying a put option there, right? So there are circumstances where you find a stock that has been performing well, which you do believe will continue to perform well. So a good example of that is Muthoot Finance. That was a stock that we got onto pretty late. The stock had run up a lot, but I looked at it, understood it, and then I felt, you know what, the stock price actually makes sense. And I'd like to hold the stock at that level. So there's a variety of outcomes that are possible here. I think the really important thing is to really go into this with a bias that is against the market view. That'll make sure that your analysis is rigorous. Okay. So let's understand what this business is actually about. So what we're after here is trying to understand how this business is delivering value to its customers. So first step is we need to understand what on earth is an active pharmaceutical ingredient. So it's basically a component of medicine that is biologically active, i.e. it has some effect in the body. And essentially when a branded manufacturer or a large MNC pharma company produces the final pill, they combine the API with other ingredients, some of which are inert and stabilizers, et cetera, to create the final pill. So Divi's manufactures these APIs for the pharma company. They are manufacturing a very important component of the final pill, but they're not manufacturing the final pill. So the supply chain looks a little bit like this. You have the global pharma company here. It develops the IP for the drug, the formulation for the drug. It outsources the manufacturer of the API to the API manufacturer, and the API manufacturer passes those components on to whoever is doing the final drug assembly, right? So already we see something interesting in this industry structure. So the supply chain is a classic outsource production supply chain. So there are lots of different examples of industries that do it. Perhaps the best known one, which a lot of you may be familiar with, is Coca-Cola. So if you understand the soda business, Coca-Cola, the soft drink, you'll know that the actual company, Coca-Cola, is nothing but a marketing company with a formula. And the actual bottling and production of the beverage is done by sister companies, which are known as bottlers. So this is a very similar model where the global pharma companies are operating as IP and research houses, but the hard manufacturing of the actual pills are being done in an outsourced manner. So already we're drawing some analogies, and doing analogies is a very good way for you to understand a new industry. So pharma is not an industry that I'm an expert in. It's not something that I've done a lot of work in pharma. So helping myself understand it better, analogies can be a huge, huge tool in doing that. Okay, so now that we understand how the industry is operating, we need to ask ourselves the question, why is this industry operating in an outsourced fashion? What value is there to outsourcing the manufacturer of the API? Why aren't the pharma companies doing it themselves? So generally, the reason that companies outsource like this is they do it when the manufacturing is complex and capital intensive, when there are regional differences in the cost of producing them. So maybe the manufacturer is based in the US and maybe it's much cheaper to produce these goods in India and China. So then outsourcing and offshoring the production is a very smart idea because you're able to produce the costs at a cheaper price, even when the manufacturer charges a margin for producing them. The third reason is cost of moving products around is cheap. if you're dealing in a product where even if the labor is cheaper, the cost of transporting that good is extremely expensive, then it could get in the way of you outsourcing products. But if you're dealing with something like a pharmaceutical where it's cheap, right, to transport, then the cost of moving the products from India and China back to the US and Europe is not going to cost you much. And the fourth, and this is a very, very important point, is that IP leakage is not an issue. IP can be protected. So you can see in China, a lot of tech intellectual property is being ripped off there, right? So the producer has to have a means to prevent the outsourced manufacturer from simply making the final drug themselves, right? So do these factors apply here? So let's try and understand for ourselves first. Is the manufacturing complex and capital intensive? It sure looks like it is. Like we discussed, a lot of employees are required. There's a lot of R&D that's required, and there's a lot of manufacturing plants that Divi's has. There's also regulatory oversight that's done when you're manufacturing drugs. So this is not an easy manufacturing process to do. So check, manufacturing is complex and capital intensive. Do regional arbitrages exist in cost of production? So is it cheaper for Divi's to manufacture these APIs than it is for Bristol-Myers to do it themselves, for example? Absolutely. Why? Because the labor costs are so much cheaper in India and China than they are in the US and Europe. So also that makes sense. Are the costs of moving products around cheap? Yes, because the pill is very light, easy to ship. And is IP leakage an issue here? No, because they're only manufacturing one component of the pill. They're not manufacturing the final pill. So do these factors apply here? Sure looks like it. And I just posted a quote here from the Divi's Lab MD. So this quote sums it up pretty nicely. The big pharma pretty much stopped the API production. Most of them sold the API manufacturing plants because they could not sustain costs. So here again, we're talking about the cost arbitrage. It is cheaper for them to produce abroad than it is in their regions. So continuing with the quote, that is the reason they have started outsourcing and they do not have any more manufacturing capabilities in the US definitely. And in majority of the European countries, number one. Two, it is not only not having the manufacturing plant. Even if somebody puts a manufacturing plant, it is very difficult to create human resources. So again, we had seen how many employees Divi's has. It's not as simple as just putting a plant in place. You got to find the bodies to be able for you to produce these pills effectively. Number three is the training. So you got to train the labor pool also. And number four is the regulatory clearances by the FDA and European authorities. You can't just set up a plant without an inspection and regulatory approval from the FDA. You have to be certified by these authorities to actually produce these drugs. And the FDA is very, very careful about having quality controls around manufacturing. So we can see that manufacturing these products is actually a very complicated process. And it makes a lot of sense why Divi's customers have chosen to outsource this. Because it's very, very capital intensive and Divi's probably has a cost edge over some of the companies that produce these intellectual property in the pharma space in terms of manufacturing. Okay, so now we kind of see at a high level what value Divi's is adding. We can now figure out how are we going to tell if Divi's is a quality participant of the API manufacturing business. So I just wanted to create a mental checklist for myself to figure out how we're going to determine how good of a business Divi's is. So the key questions in my mind that come up at this point are, one, how competitive is the API manufacturing business? It sure looks like it's complicated to do, but are there lots of different outfits that are able to do this? You know, one is the competitiveness in India, but what about the competitiveness globally? Are there other regions that are focused on API manufacturing and how does India compare and how does Divi compare within India? The second is customer concentration. How many customers does Divi's have? Because these pharma companies are huge. And if you're beholden to 2, 3, 4, 5 customers, if one of them pulls out, you could see, you know, 20% of your business evaporate overnight. So that's also another thing that I want to understand. Are there any examples of global pharma companies deciding to do the opposite and in-house API manufacturing? So is there any example of a pharma company that's decided, you know what, we're not happy outsourcing, we're going to do the API manufacturing in-house? What are the economies of scale of the business? If Divi's is one of the largest players in API manufacturing, does that mean it is more efficient at producing the next API? That's what economies of scale means. Do you get more efficient producing the larger and larger you get? If yes, that's a good answer. So that's another thing I want to check out for. And the last is the capital intensity of the business. How much do you have to reinvest in this business to maintain your growth? And that's one of the things that I'm going to be focused on in also assessing the quality of the lease. Okay, so let's take a look at the financials for some quick clues as to the quality of this business. So I went through the annual report and, you know, in very much the same style as we did with Britannia, I looked at the key numbers in the income statement and I drew some conclusions from them. So a couple of things to point out for you guys. One, if we look at the revenue growth, right, we've got 4 years of revenue here. It is very, very lumpy. So I'm going to want to understand what is going on. So in FY17-18, for example, they declined 4%, then they went up 26%, then they went up 9.5%. So revenue growth is all over the place. It's not a steady eddy business. I really want to understand what's driving that differential in revenue growth. Another thing is, if you look at the average growth rate over that period, it's been around 10.1%, which is good. It's not astronomically high. We looked at Britannia not too long ago, and Britannia had a very similar growth rate. So it's a good growth rate, but not something just off the charts. One of the things that was off the charts here, though, was the gross margin. So this business generates a 62% gross margin. If you recall in the Britannia series, I told you guys that a gross margin above 40 is good. So a gross margin above 60 is very, very good. It tells me that they're able to charge a heavy premium on the product, on the price they're selling these products for versus the cost that it's costing them to manufacture. And the only reason the customers would agree to that pricing differential is if A, they didn't have options, or B, Divi's was doing a really good job at delivering the products and they were fine paying that higher price. So either way, it tells us that this business is adding some value. It doesn't tell us concretely, but it's very, very suggestive of that fact. The other thing that struck me was that when you look at the operating expenses and the average growth rate of the operating expenses over the 4 years, they've grown at 11%, which is actually faster than the revenue growth. This is not something you want to see as an investor. I want to see that the operating expenses grow slower than the revenue, because that means my profitability is going to increase over time as the business keeps growing. My profit margins will keep getting higher and higher, but that's not the case in this business. The expenses are growing as fast as the revenue, which tells me that they're growing, but they're having to reinvest a lot in the business to propel that growth. So that's a very, very important consideration as we think about the quality of that growth. And as a result, it's not surprising for us to see that the earnings per share has only grown at 9%. Per year on average. That's not high at all. So despite growing revenue at 10%, they're growing their EPS at less than 10% because their expenses are growing so quickly. So that speaks to how challenging this business is. And the last thing that I took note of on the income statement was the fact that the operating margins are above 30%. That's very, very healthy. And again, that's related to the fact that their gross margins are so high. Tells me that this is a business that, again, is adding a lot of value in the value chain. Okay, so the last thing I looked at was the capital expenditures. And that's from the cash flow statement. And you remember that one of the things that I'm very focused on in understanding the Divi's business is I want to understand how capital intensive it is. So I already got one clue that it's pretty capital intensive because the expenses grow so quickly, right? We know that they have to reinvest a lot in expenses to drive their revenue growth. The second is look at the amount that they're reinvesting in the form of capital expenditures. So again, capital expenditures are investments in plant and machinery and hard assets. So we can see they're spending a lot in capital expenditures. So in FY19-20, they spent 118,321 lakhs of, these numbers are in lakhs. Sorry, I should have labeled the units, but these are in lakhs. So they spent 1183 crores in capital expenditures, which is approximately, doing the math, around 20% of the sales were reinvested in the form of CapEx. That is a massive amount of CapEx. So this is clearly a very capital intensive business. Okay, so that was my key takeaways from the income statement. Then what I did is I looked at the recent performance. They released their Q1 numbers recently, and the performance was very strong. Q1 revenue was up 47%. Their earnings per share was up 81%. And then I read the transcript to see what they were saying about the performance. There's one quote here that's meaningful, just reading it. But I am saying that yes, a part of this is a growth, part of it is a lumpiness, and some of it is a favorable products mix. So essentially, he's saying that the growth was good, but not all of it is actually organic growth of the business. There's some lumpiness in that number and some favorable mix that we can't count on happening again and again. So maybe the business didn't grow a full 47%, but it certainly did grow. And, you know, so we're going to have to haircut what we think is actually happening in the business. It's not actually growing 47% on a comparable basis. And then he went on to say, I think we are very strong to take significant market share in all our generic products, where we have long-term contracts with our customers, and customers are always increasing their business. So that's a good thing. They're gaining market share. That's a very good thing to see. So recent performance has been good, not as good as the 47% probably suggests, but definitely good. So summarizing our findings from the financials, because we covered a lot. One, the margin structure suggests this is a value-added business. You're not going to see many businesses that are not adding value have such good margins. The margins at the gross level being above 60% and at the operating margin level being above 30% implies customers are willing to pay to use Divi's. That's telling me that they're adding value. Otherwise, why else would the customers pay? Revenue performance is very lumpy. We'll want to understand why, and also that's very important as we think about understanding the quarterly performance. We shouldn't read too much into a quarter being up 40% because the next one may be down 20%, right? So we're going to really, really want to understand the growth here. Next point, growth seems very capital and operationally intensive. There's very little operating leverage. So how did we get that conclusion? Because the operating expenses were growing quickly and because the capital expenditures were high. So this tells me this is a business at maturity that's not going to be capable of growing EPS more than 10% per year at maturity. If it is so capital intensive, it is highly unlikely that when this business is mature, it's going to be growing quickly because you're not getting that increase in profitability as it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. So it's not a very quick grower on the EPS line once the business is mature. The fourth point I got was COVID-19 seems to be having a good impact on the business. Q1 performance was strong. And it does seem like they're benefiting a little bit from the China supply chain diversification. So a lot of people in the US and Europe are not wanting to use China as a supplier. So it does seem that Divi's is picking up some share from that, which is benefiting their business. And the last point is, I didn't show you their balance sheet, but there are no notable takeaways on the balance sheet. Very clean balance sheet, very little debt. So balance sheet is clean. So that's my key findings from the financials. Some other tidbits that I pulled from the annual report that are salient that I'm drawing some inferences from. First is geographic split of sales. So if we look at this, around 70% of their sales is coming from Europe and the Americas. Only around 15% are coming from India and 11% from Asia, and very little coming from rest of the world, so Africa, essentially. So what does this tell us? It confirms our understanding of the business. It seems that this business is really appealing to supply chain diversification. The end customers are sitting in high-cost geographies like Europe and the Americas. They're getting the products produced in cheaper locations like India, and that's driving a lot of the value that this business is adding. That's why we're seeing 70% of the sales are going to high-cost regions. The other thing we were concerned about is how concentrated the portfolio is, and certainly we can see that concentration. So in the annual report, it mentioned that the largest product line that they're developing is 18% of sales. Can you imagine if there was some problem with that product? If there was a recall on that product, or if there was some adverse findings that were found out that, oh, this product causes cancer or something, overnight you'd see 18% of your sales evaporate. So this is why we're very concerned with portfolio concentration. So you have a high degree of concentration here. The top five products account for 45% of sales. And the top five customers are 36% of sales. Why do we care about the customers? Well, we know how tough customers can be. If any of you have run a business serving other businesses, you will know how hard they negotiate. And similarly, these pharma companies are huge companies. They have a lot of bargaining power. So understanding how much power they have with Divi's is important. And here you can see they have a lot of power, because the top five customers account for 36% of the sales, which means on average, the top five is looking at around 7% of sales. So maybe the top customers around 15% of sales. It's quite possible. So that customer is going to have a lot of bargaining power with Divi's. The last tidbit that I found from the annual report that was helpful was that 50% of the raw materials are imported. So 50% of the materials that Divi is buying to produce its APIs is coming from somewhere outside of India. And my guess is a large portion of those intermediate supplies are coming from China. We all know the government in India is very also careful about the relationship with China. So understanding that risk, if there's any risk to the ability of Divi's getting its supply from China to produce these APIs, that could be another risk that we need to watch out for. Okay, there's another thing. So anytime you're doing a high level check on a company, you should always do a news search on them. Okay, so doing a quick news search on Divi's, this headline came up quite recently. So SEBI alleges insider trading by Divi's Laboratories, CFO, seven others. This is not something you generally want to see in a company that you're invested in. One of the biggest risks about investing in India relative to what I'm seen in the US, for example, is there's a lot more risk of corporate malfeasance in India because our economy is more complex. The regulatory systems are less developed. So you need, as an investor, you need to be hyper-focused on corporate governance. You don't want to see examples of people at the company doing things like this. So this is definitely something that's on my radar as I'm going to analyze the stock. This is going to factor into my decision-making on what to do with the Divi's. Okay, so now that I've done a fair bit of work, right, it's been pretty quick work, but it's given me a good idea of Divi's. And now I need to ask myself the question, do I want to do more detailed work on this stock or not? Because it's not a free option, right? I could always take that time that I'm spending studying Divi's and study another company. So here are the key questions that I ask when I decide whether a stock is worth doing extra work on or not. One, does this fit in with my overall view of the world? So, like I said, I'm a big fan of doing work on the macro side where you have an overall view of what's going on in the world. And does this investment fit in with what you think is going to happen in the future? So for those that aren't familiar, you can see my video on COVID to get a sense of how I'm thinking about the world. Or for members, you can see my research reports that have discussed this ad nauseum. But essentially, the short answer is yes. I believe pharma is a good space to look at. It's going to see increased demand and stability, unlike many other sectors. So many sectors, you're going to actually see reduced demand because customers and consumers are hurting and credit is not freely available. But pharma is one area where the demand is through the roof right now, if you're in the right spaces. just look at how many supplements people are buying right now, how much zinc they're buying, how much vitamin B they're buying, how much vitamin D they're buying, how much antivirals they're buying, how much remdesivir is being sold. Clearly, pharmaceuticals are moving. If you are in the right products in pharma, you're going to see increasing demand. Okay. So that is a check. I'm also concerned personally about the Indian consumption story. I think we all saw the Indian GDP numbers. They were very, very poor. Our GDP contracted the most out of any major economy. So clearly, the Indian economy is on the back foot. And I personally believe that companies that are overly reliant on the Indian consumer spending may face some headwinds. So when I look at Divi's, I like the fact that only 15% of its sales are coming from India, and the bulk of its sales are coming from export markets like the US and Europe, where it's insulated a bit from the unique challenges that we're seeing in the Indian consumption story. That's a personal view. You can read my thoughts on why I think that's going to be the case in some of my notes. But you don't have to agree with that, right? That's just my macro view of what's going on. I do believe that Indian manufacturing could get a boost as people shift supply chains away from China. I think this is a very real thing that's happening. I think you're seeing a lot of people wanting to diversify away from China. I think India could be a great place that absorbs some of that manufacturing capacity. So I also like the fact that Divi's is squarely going to benefit from that trend if it's able to pick up share from a shift in supply chains away from China. First, okay, the second thing I ask is, so in topic one, it clearly seems to fit my worldview of the world. And you don't need to agree with that worldview. You have to ask yourself, what is my worldview and does that fit in my worldview? Second thing is, first blush, does this look like a high quality company? So when I look at it, it's a bit of a mixed bag. So the gross margins and operating margins are suggestive that the company is adding a lot of value. So it seems like they're doing a good job. But I have some concerns around governance and the quality of the earnings call I listened to was a little weak. But because of the company's margins, I'm willing to give it the benefit of the doubt. And I'll say that on balance, it does look like a high quality company to me. So point two, check. Third point, does the valuation look reasonable at first glance? Now, this is the tough one. 55 times LTM PE is high. No doubt about it, particularly for a capital intensive business where the EPS is not growing all that fast. However, because of what's going on in the macro side of the world, we may see a period where the EPS is turbocharged. And that, if you can believe and convince yourself of that, it may justify the PE. And that's why I will say yes to this third point also. And I'm going to discuss this third point in a little more detail because it may be a little confusing. So here's what I need to do to convince myself that the valuation for Divi's makes sense. So no question, at maturity, for a business that is capable of growing its EPS at less than 10%, it does not deserve to trade at a 55 times PE multiple. No way, right? However, is there an opportunity that in the short run, we're going to see faster than 10% EPS growth? Yes, because if you're a believer that supply chains are going to shift to India, and therefore Indian API manufacturers are going to get an opportunity to capture share, then could this convince you that the valuation may be justified? Absolutely. But how do we go about answering that question? And the key is we want to figure out a couple of things. So let's look at this chart here for a second. I have graphed EPS here on the left-hand side and time on the bottom axis. And we are right now at this point here, okay? And we're measuring the PE on a trailing basis. So we're saying that the PE is 55 times based on the trailing 12 months of earnings per share. We think there may be an opportunity that you see a step change in the PE, in the earnings per share. Why? Because there's an opportunity for Indian manufacturers to get growth. So the key question that I'm going to explore as I analyze Divi's is, do I believe this huge step change is possible. Do I believe that Divi's can dramatically grow its EPS and stabilize at a much higher EPS level, and off that higher base, grow at its typical rate? So that's kind of the analysis I'm going to be trying to do. I'm going to try and ask myself the question, how high do I think its EPS can grow due to market share gains? And what will the PE look like at that level once that opportunity is captured? Then I'll be able to say, okay, I think it's going to be able to, let's say, double its PE. So then I'm not really a double its EPS. So I'm not really buying the company at 55 times PE. I'm buying it at 27 and a half times PE. Does the company deserve to be 27 and a half times PE? That makes my job easier. So that's how I'm going to think of figuring out whether the valuation makes sense or not. So that's my game plan for trying to analyze this company further. Okay, so great. Now we have an action plan. We've decided that, we don't have an action plan, but we've decided that it's worth doing work on Divi's. Looks pretty good as a first blush. Now time to do serious work, because all the things we've done so far is just sort of high level work, not really gotten into the details. And the secret to really, really good stock analysis is to dive into the details. So what are we going to do for the future? So the plan that I've crafted is, first, I want to understand the API manufacturing market. I want to understand how much share China has. How likely is that to shift? How likely, if it shifts, is India to capture that share? It may go to Vietnam, it may go to other low-cost geographies, right? India is not the only manufacturing hub globally that can capture the share. Then, if it does go to India, will Divi's be the one to pick up that share? Who does Divi's compete with? How is it positioned versus others? Is there any risk of pharma companies saying, we'll just do it ourselves, we don't need Divi's, you know? So I need to answer those questions about the API market. Then the next step is, I need to get in an idea in my mind of what Divi's EPS will look like once the opportunity above is captured. So if I think there's an opportunity, I need to translate that into actual financials. Do I think Divi's can double sales? Do I think it can triple sales? What will EPS look like under those variety of scenarios? And what will the PE ratio look like under those scenarios? That's going to give me a lot of help in terms of determining whether the valuation is justified. Then what are the risks here? Regulatory risk, governance risks. You know, we could see some action by the government which seriously messes up the supply chain and ability to get its supplies from China. You know, that's a risk. I got to think about that risk. I got to think of the governance issues that we've seen with Divi's. I want to think of the customer risk. I didn't put it here on this slide, but that's another big one. The customer concentration and product concentration risks. And the last one, and this is an important one also, Divi's is not the only way to play this trend. Is it the best way to play this trend? Even Dr. Reddy's has an API manufacturing unit. Should we look at that instead? Is that a better deal? So that's also another thing that I'm going to explore as I do my due diligence on Divi's. So with that, a lot we've covered. I'm going to open it up for Q&A. Again, I went through a lot of information very quickly. If you are lost, watch our Stocks Zero to Hero and then watch this video again. But with that, I'll open it up for any questions that have come through.
Yeah, so there's a bunch of questions on the chat. And sure. For those who still have questions, keep posting them. So the first question is, where did you get that performance chart from?
So that I just pulled from Google. I just finance.google.com. But there are lots of different sources you can pull the charts from. There's Money Control, you know, various ticker tape. There are lots of sites where you can pull it.
Okay. Do you think Divi's will grow organically or inorganically or both?
Good question. So this is a very deep question, actually, because I think in the case of Divi's, there is no such thing as organic growth. And that's a pretty controversial statement, what I'm saying. But what I mean by that is, every time Divi's gets another product to produce APIs for, it requires them to rejigger their supply chain a little bit. They may have been making, for example, gabapentin. Okay. and their plants are geared towards making gabapentin. Now suddenly they get an order for a remdesivir component that they need to manufacture. Maybe the manufacturing of this is totally different. Maybe it needs to be in cold storage. Maybe it needs to, you know, have a completely different chemical staff working on it. So every time they grow by adding a product line, it's a bit inorganic because they may need to rejigger. And this is a hypothesis, okay? I'm not an expert in pharma, but based on my work now, my suspicion is that truly growing organically here, you're going to see much less organic growth than you're going to see actual inorganic growth of new factories, new lines, more employees needing to be added, which is in some ways inorganic. But I, in terms of inorganic through acquisitions, etc., I haven't studied the space enough to know whether they can turbocharge their growth through acquisitions.
Okay. So I think you touched upon a few of their competitors like Dr. Reddy's and stuff, but basically, who are their key competitors in India? Could they acquire, grow share? How would you find this data?
Really good question. So the truth of the answer is I have not done that work yet. So I don't want to speak in terms of the competitive landscape in this video. I'm going to address it in the next video once I've done my due diligence. But a good way to figure out the competitors is through finding third-party research on the space. So we have the benefit of dealing with a very well-researched space here. Pharma is a very well-studied and researched space. So simply finding a few brokerage reports or finding a consulting report that on the pharma space can be a very good way to get an idea of the overall market. The other way you can do it is you can, for example, I know that Dr. Reddy's has a segment in their business called API, active pharmaceutical manufacturing. So I already know one competitor. So when I start reading about Dr. Reddy's, I may find another competitor because in Dr. Reddy's earnings calls, in their annual report, they may call out competitors. Oftentimes you will see that in companies' materials where they actually mention competitors. Then Google can also be a great way to find big, large API manufacturers. So more to come on the competitive landscape next time. I'll give you my findings, and also to address the member's question, I will also tell you how I found that information out. I'll give you a sense of the research I did to answer that question.
Okay. With 100% of pharma companies in India operating in different levels of supply chain, and a lot of them listed across market caps, what should one's approach be to analyze pharma in India?
So I'm not a pharma expert. It's very difficult for me to talk in terms of industry at large because I don't know it that well enough to say, you know, this would be my approach, that would be my approach. The way that I generally recommend, if you wanted to answer that question, right, you got to understand first and foremost, you got to understand the listed companies that are the leading companies in that segment very, very well. So here we've done Divi's, right? But then we got to understand Cadila, we got to understand Dr. Reddy's, we got to understand, you know, the various players that are there. You create a chart for yourself of what each company is doing, right? Are they manufacturing generics like Dr. Reddy's and doing a little bit of API manufacturing? Or are they pure play API manufacturers? Or are they branded pharmaceutical companies? Or are they vaccine manufacturers? You know, so by really understanding the nuts and bolts of the business, it's a slow process to sort of understand an industry really, really well. Okay. But the good news is you don't necessarily need to understand an industry through and through to make an investment decision. So here, for example, I understand the value that Divi's is adding. I don't need to understand everything about pharma to make an investment here. I just need to make sure I understand specifically with API manufacturing, what are the key factors that are going to determine if API manufacturers do well. I don't need to understand about vaccine manufacturers to make a call on Divi's. I need to understand about global pharma, whether it's outsourcing, insourcing, whether the demand for drugs is increasing, decreasing, whether India is well positioned and whether Divi's is well positioned within India. If I've answered all of that, I'm good to go. So I don't need to worry too much about all those other things.
Okay. With the revenue growth fluctuating so much every quarter, what gives us confidence that they will grow quarter on quarter?
Good question. So what does not give us confidence is the fact that they grew 47%, because like you said, that number benefits from lumpiness. What does give us confidence is the fact that management said some of that is actually market share gains and underlying growth. So management has told us, look, we didn't actually grow 47% in terms of pure operating performance. Some of it's lumpiness. But we did grow, we did get market share. It was a good quarter. So we do know they grew. How much, we're not sure. What you can do is some of the math that I'm going to try and do when I do diligence to these. I'm going to try and basically say, look, who are the key players in India in API manufacturing? How much share does China have? How much of that share is going to move away? And these are all estimates and assumptions I'm going to make based on my research. Right? And they're not going to be precise. You can never be 100% on, but you need to have some idea of, is this a 1,000 crore opportunity for Divi's? Is this a 2,000 crore opportunities for Divi's? Is this a 10,000 crore opportunities for Divi's? Right? That's what I'm trying to answer. And the way I'm going to do it is by understanding how large these markets are, how much share would need to shift to India, and how much of that will Divi's need to capture for these numbers to be meaningful? And if the answer is a lot, then a 55 times PE is probably not warranted, and I probably won't take a large position in the stock. If, on the other hand, it doesn't really require very heroic assumptions to see their EPS double, then you know what, 27 times may be a little expensive, but you know, maybe it's justified, right? So that's kind of the calculus I'll be doing.
Okay. So
these are very, very good questions, guys. And these are exactly the same questions I'm going to be asking as I'm doing further research on the lease.
Okay. There's another question. You said that if the EPS doubles, the PE can be justified to be 27, which is half of the current EPS. What exactly did you mean by that?
What I mean by that is this. Let's say that I have a lemonade stand, okay, that's selling Nimbu Pani in one stand and generating, let's say, 100 rupees in earnings per share. I have set up another stand, okay, and it's going to take me 1 year to get that stand going and generating earnings in the future. But I'm fairly confident that that stand will also do 100 rupees in earnings. If I value my business on just one lemonade stand, right, I'd be valuing it off of 100 rupees. If, on the other hand, I'm willing to give credit for that second Nimbu Pani stand, suddenly I'm valuing it off of 200 rupees in earnings per share. So my price to earnings ratio is not going to be price over 100 rupees. It's going to be price over 200 rupees. So what I mean by that is, if you're willing to give credit for certain things that are going to happen in the future, and you're willing to include that earnings into your denominator, your PE ratio will go down. When will you actually give credit to something? If you believe it's pretty likely to happen, right? If I think there's no way this Nimbu Pani stand will fail, 100% I'm going to get 100 rupees in EPS, then I'll put it into my denominator, no problem. If, on the other hand, I think, hey, there's a big risk it could be zero, there's a chance it could be 100 rupees, there's a chance it could be 200 rupees, there's a chance it could be negative 50 rupees, then I'm not going to take it into my denominator to calculate the PE ratio. So the question is really, will I get enough comfort in the case of Divi's to give Divi's credit for doubling its EPS? If yes, then it's not really trading at 55 times, because I'm giving it credit for doubling the EPS, and hence it's trading at 27 times.
Okay. How do you justify high CMP and still recommend?
How do I justify high?
CMP and still recommend.
I didn't get the acronym.
I don't know what CMP
is. CMP is current market price.
Oh, current market price. Okay.
So good question. Current market price is not a very meaningful metric to me. Really what you need to do when you analyze whether a stock is expensive or not is just not look at the current market price. You got to look at the PE ratio, right? Because you're paying, but you're also receiving something. So you can't calculate a net price by just looking at the CMP. You've got to take that CMP and divide by earnings per share to calculate the PE ratio. Now your question is still correct. Vivi's is not only trading at a high CMP, it's also trading at a high price to earnings ratio. How can we justify an investment? We can justify the investment by saying that look around you. How many industries are actually doing well right now? How many industries are actually seeing growth? How many industries are increasing their EPS? How many industries are benefiting from increased demand? There are not many industries that are growing in this environment. So businesses that are managing to grow are becoming more and more valuable. If you can convince yourself that Divi's has a great runway ahead of it because pharma is a good place to be, because they are going to gain share within API manufacturing, then you can justify a very high PE. If you can't, then you're absolutely right. You cannot invest in the company. So I'm not saying either way right now, right? I've not reached a conclusion. This is the first step. I think there's enough that's interesting about Divi's that I want to deepen the due diligence to try to answer. Do I believe that this company, do I believe a 55 times PE is justified for this company or not? That's what I'm trying to answer.
Okay, so I think there's no more question in the chat. So we can conclude this session.
Great. Well, I just want to say that a lot of the questions are bang on, asking exactly the same questions that I'm going to be trying to answer as I take the research further in the next session on Divi's, where we're going to try to map out the competitive dynamics, where we're going to try to do some math around the earnings per share to see, is it even in the realm of possibility for Divi's to double its EPS? If not, very unlikely that we're going to invest in it. If yes, maybe there's a chance. So that's kind of the next steps from here. So thanks for joining, guys. And this is going to be a regular feature, not just on Divi's. We're going to go through, you know, whatever stocks that I'm looking at for my small case, when I find one that's interesting for the video sessions, we'll broadcast our sort of thinking and what work we're doing around it. And it's fun to discuss this stuff and also get good questions from you guys to make the analysis better. So thanks everyone for joining. And
yeah, and also for members, please, if you have questions, send them to advisory@bharosaclub.com.
Yes. All right, everybody. Thank you so much. Chalo. Bye.
Thank you.